In today's video, we are going to talk about how it is possible that nutrition studies keep contradicting one another. It seems like every week there's a new headline all over mainstream media making a radical health claim. A slice of bacon a day increases your risk of cancer. A cup of fruit reduces your diabetes risk. Olive oil can extend your lifespan. Sometimes these headlines are consistent and follow a similar narrative, but other times, they directly contradict one another. It can be very overwhelming trying to figure out what to eat with so much conflicting information coming at us from all angles. How on earth are we supposed to know what we should be eating? The good news is that there are a few ways to tell if the claims in these headlines are worth considering. So in today's video, we are going to talk about why nutrition studies keep contradicting one another, the difference between correlation and causation, and how to figure out which diet is best for you. Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, my name's Kate. I'm a health coach and I post videos on a high-fat, nutrient-dense way of eating. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up, feel free to share, and make sure to subscribe. Make sure to follow me on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook, where I share new posts every single day. Now, as I said at the start, it can be very overwhelming trying to figure out what to eat with so much conflicting information. One day, low-carb diets are good for weight loss. The next day, they don't work and aren't sustainable. So which is it? We're going to start off today talking about why there's so much conflicting information when it comes to nutrition studies. Then we will get into how to tell if a source is valid or not, and we will finish off by talking about how to figure out what diet is best for you. And if you do like this video, consider sharing it with a friend or in a Facebook group who you think would also find it helpful. Nutrition study limitations. Now, I am not here to tell you that nutrition science is entirely corrupt, that there is some big conspiracy going on. That's not what this video is going to be about. There is actually a few valid reasons why the nutrition studies we read about in headlines often contradict one another. The first reason is that it is simply not possible to conduct long-term, rigorous studies when it comes to nutrition. The best types of studies are experimental studies, where researchers are in control of the variables. Because nutrition studies have to be done on humans, or the best type do at least, you can only control people's eating habits for so long. It would be unethical to study someone in a controlled environment for 50 years, let alone 10 years or even 5. But that is how long you would need to really figure out what variables of a diet lead to what health outcomes. But because you cannot do this, a lot of nutrition studies last less than 6 months. Then there is obviously the issue of finances. Studies like this are expensive, and the longer they go, the more expensive they will be. So this is yet another constraint. And then there's the dilemma of funding. In order to conduct a study like this, researchers need to be funded. But where does this money come from? A lot of the times, companies will fund a study that relates to the product they're trying to sell, with the hope that the outcome will be in their favor. For example, Coca-Cola has very famously funded scientists who say that our obesity crisis is due to a lack of exercise, and that sugar-sweetened beverages play no part at all. There are, of course, rules in place that are supposed to prevent conflicts of interest like this from happening, but there are also loopholes. The point is that researchers are in a dilemma. They need funding in order to conduct these studies, but this funding often comes from large corporations with a vested interest. Now, I am not saying that all nutrition studies are worthless, of course. There is definitely value in a lot of them, but you just need to know what red flags to look out for when you come across an article making a big claim. The first of which being knowing the difference between correlation and causation. What do I mean by this? A correlation means there's a connection between two or more things, while causation means that one thing caused another. Sometimes a correlation can be causation, but other times not. For example, ice cream sales and sunburns are correlated. When ice cream sales are up, more people get sunburned. But does this mean that eating ice cream puts you at a greater risk of getting burnt? No, it doesn't. There is another variable, which is the weather. On hot, sunny days, people are more likely to be eating ice cream and also to be out in the sun for longer periods of time. But how does this relate to nutrition? As we already discussed, it is impossible to conduct long-term controlled studies when it comes to nutrition. But there is another long-term option: observational studies. These types of studies look at large groups of people who are living their lives and draw connections between factors such as their diet and health outcomes. The way these types of studies collect data is through food frequency questionnaires. These questionnaires ask participants what and how often they eat certain foods. I'm sure you can already start to see some of the drawbacks of collecting data through this method, one of which being the data is based on self-reporting. Participants are asked to remember and accurately record how many serves of a food they had per week. If I were to ask you how many serves of bacon you had per week over the last year, do you think you would be able to give an accurate answer? The other drawback is something called the healthy user bias. People who eat healthy are also more likely to not smoke, not drink, exercise regularly, etc. All of these factors are likely contributing to their health, so it is hard to pinpoint which one is leading to the health outcomes. Because of all these limitations, observational studies can only find correlations. For example, red meat consumption has been cited in the past as being correlated with heart disease. But as we already discussed, correlation does not equal causation. These types of studies are meant to form hypotheses, which researchers can then investigate further through more rigorous trials. The problem is that observational studies like this are often the ones being cited in these flashy headlines. And you will notice that these headlines are very careful with their wording. They will use words like linked to or associated with to describe the connection between food and health outcomes. And this is because they know this evidence isn't conclusive. Of course, you can never be 100% certain when it comes to scientific research, but you can be a whole lot more certain with experimental studies than with observational ones. So the next time you're reading an article making a radical claim, check out the source and the method of the study. If it was an observational study, definitely take it with a grain of salt. But if it was an experimental study, yes, that carries more weight. But there are a few other considerations which we are going to talk about now. Experimental study considerations. Just because a study is a control trial does not mean the findings are 100% accurate or applicable to everyone. There are some considerations that you need to keep in mind. How long was the study? If the study was only 1 week long, that really isn't long enough to see any significant results from a diet change. Something might be effective short term, but not long term. Let's use the example of a severely calorie-restricted diet where participants were eating less than 1,000 calories a day. This is definitely an effective short-term strategy to lose weight. But the catch is that after severe calorie restriction for multiple months, metabolism starts to slow down, and you will have to reduce calories further in order to continue to lose weight. In this example, a study that lasts for a couple of weeks or a month, yes, it will yield positive results, but the results are not maintainable. Was the study done on humans or animals? A lot of studies are done on mice, and while this can be a good jumping-off point, the results do not always translate for humans. How many people were included in the study? A study done on 5 people does not carry the same weight as a study done on 100 people, all other factors considered, of course. Did the researchers use surrogate markers or endpoints? An example of a surrogate marker is cholesterol levels. If a study was trying to determine whether or not eating blueberries, for example, reduces your heart disease risk, they might look at changes in cholesterol levels and determine that because cholesterol decreased, the risk of heart disease decreased as well. However, this might not be directly related. And even though cholesterol levels lowered, if the same people still had heart attacks despite this, it doesn't really mean anything. Has the study been replicated? Are there examples of other studies with the same findings? If the conclusion of the study is meaningful, it should be able to be replicated. Who was the study funded by? discussed earlier, of course, be wary of a study claiming that eating cereal for breakfast is healthy if it was funded by Kellogg's. What diet is best for you? If you've made it this far in the video, I applaud you for sticking with me. It may seem overwhelming to have to fact check every nutrition article you read, and believe me, I totally get that. At the end of the day, we know our own bodies best, and we can run experiments on ourselves and track our results. I often have people reach out to me saying something along the lines of, I have been eating keto for a year. I've lost 50 pounds. My blood pressure is now normal. I am no longer type 2 diabetic. My arthritis has improved, but my doctor is worried about my cholesterol and says I should change my diet. Now, cholesterol is a whole other topic for another day. I do have another video where I talk about why cholesterol sometimes goes up and LDL specifically on a ketogenic diet. So I will link that above if you want to check it out afterwards. But long story short, you need to look at the big picture. If you have improved a bunch of health ailments, if you have lost a lot of weight, if you are feeling great, clearly you're doing something right. Don't let some flashy headline or story about your mom, sister's friend failing with keto or any diet for that matter dissuade you if you are feeling great and seeing results. The moral of the story is that there is so much we still do not know about nutrition and how it relates to our health. The science is not settled on any front because, as we discussed earlier, nutrition is extremely difficult to study. Experiment and tweak to figure out what works best for you. Of course, blood tests can be healthy, but even a lot of the reference ranges are not applicable to everyone. Anyways, guys, that's all I have for you today. Let me know in the comment section down below, what was the most outrageous nutrition headline you've ever seen? Your comments, likes, and of course your subscriptions help to support my channel. So thank you very much if you take the time to do any of those. And if you do want to support me further and gain some additional perks, you can click the join button down below to become a Health Coach Kate member, and you will gain early access to all of my videos. And if you did enjoy this video, you might also like my video on how to reduce visceral fat, which you can check out right here. If you want to catch up on my most recent upload, you can find it here. And if you want to take a look at my keto diet and carnivore diet coaching programs, you can find them here. Thanks again, guys. I'll see you next time. Bye.